From a partly sunny Autzen Stadium in Eugene, it is time to start the football season. This afternoon, the Portland State Vikings from Division II take on the University of Oregon Ducks.
And a very short kick angled near side, Austin at the 13. Austin is out to the 40-yard line, so good field position for Portland State. 27-yard return for Larry Austin. A year ago, felt they should have been better. O'Neill is determined to prove the Ducks will be a better football team this year. They start out in this H formation with a fullback kind of slotted to the left. Dino Filia, the first carry, and he is batted right at the 35 and falls forward to the 37-yard line. Jeff Bockert, number 44, outstanding inside linebacker for the Vikings. This is Marcel Stewart, a transfer. His first carry as a Duck plows forward into Portland State territory, a gain of 3. Ken, we talked about all last year, and it's been the talk in the spring and the fall. Oregon wants to be a better team at running the football. And last year, the lowest production in Rich Brooks's tenure here at Oregon, less than 1,000 yards net rushing.
Well, the inability to run the football has really hurt Oregon the past couple years, particularly down the latter stages of the season. Situation like this, they're almost inclined to go for it to develop that offensive line and try to wear down potentially a smaller defense.
O'Neill looks like he's audibilizing here. Vikings show five-man rush. They give it to the fullback, Dwayne Jones, and he is stood up at the 45-yard line. A gain of 3. It'll be third down and 4.
Getting back to the running game, Todd, at times it's not seemed that Oregon does not have a running attack chosen to really feature it.
Well, when you have a quarterback like O'Neill and receivers like Detweiler and McLemore last year and a tight end that was very good, you are prone more to go to your strength.
Well, it's hard to argue with the results because in terms of yards and points, everything was great.
Yeah, but over 4,000 yards of total offense. Third down, O'Neill underneath, Corey Murphy caught. O'Neill and Murphy combined for a first down at the PSU 36-yard line. Corey Murphy, you talk about a guy with incentive today from Benson High School in Portland. Eric Reese, the starting safety from Philomath High School, made the tackle.
Well, O'Neill has converted the 2 straight third down conversions. Interesting to see. Portland State's been in a fairly conservative zone.
Oregon has the lead, so both teams scoring on their first offensive possessions. So Matt Belden ready to kick off again. His last kick only went down to about the 15-yard line. He'd like to do a little better than that. He's got a wind at his back. Steve Pappin and Larry Austin deep. This time it's Pappin on the near side. Belden this time with a much better kick as far as distance. Austin fields it 4 yards deep. He will bring it out. Slips and falls on the Omni turf. Well, that last drive by Oregon, impressive. 8 plays, 65 yards, consumed just over 4 minutes on the clock. O'Neill was 4 for 4 on the drive. He was a 62% passer last year, 54 yards and the touchdown, 33 yards out to McLemore. 30-yard punt, no return by Crowell, who has the Vikings points this afternoon with a 45-yard field goal. Take a look at the great tradition that Portland State has had at the quarterback position. June Jones not doing too bad right now, although maybe not knowing what he did yesterday.
You know what's interesting about June Jones? He's now coaching the guy who coached him. He's the head coach. Mouse Davis is his assistant, offensive coordinator.
That's right. And Danny O'Neill, not bad himself. Oregon's had a great tradition at the quarterback position as well. They'll give the ball to Filia, looking for that seam. And boy, if he gets a seam, he can go. And this time a little better surge by the offensive line of nearly 4 yards. Eric Reed on that left side, a junior from Poway, California. Travis Beard, the outside linebacker for Portland State, made the stop from North Salem High School. And then went on to Walla Walla Community College. Second down, let's call it a long 5. Corey Murphy split near slot side, and in the slot is Kristen McLemore. They go with a counter play to Filion. He doesn't get anywhere. He is nailed by Brian Stromberg. Brian Stromberg, one of 2 Viking defenders that are celebrating birthdays today. Stromberg is 23 today, and Larry Austin, the starting corner, is 22. And they feel that Stromberg may not get all the notoriety of the rest of the defense, but he might be their most consistent player.
Well, particularly at the Division II level, they have outstanding defensive players, and particularly up front, where normally you get some cast off.
First and goal from the two. This is Kenny Wheaton, and he is met at the two and thrown back. A penalty flag thrown in the middle of the pile. Boy, that Viking defense up front is tough right now. Frank Stammers.
And there, I think they're aware that that's a factor in this game.
O'Neill to throw on first down. Good protection, pumping up, looking for Josh Wilcox. He's got it in the end zone for a touchdown. He beat the linebacker, Travis Beard. Quarterback with 1:16 remaining in the first quarter. So didn't take long for Rich Brooks to go to his backup. Graziani, a little swing pass for Filion. Filion looking upfield, saw Travis Beard and decided he wasn't going to get that one.
Well, we talked to Mike Bellotti, the offensive coordinator and quarterback coach, yesterday. He said that coming into fall, they told Tony, hey, if things look, you know, you look well, we're going to give you some quality playing time early. Frankly, his performance in fall camp was not as sharp as they'd hoped, and they thought that was kind of a dilemma they had to work with the score being as is. O'Neill 7-for-7. It gives him some breathing room to look at Graziani and get him the quality work that he needs.
Graziani, a 6'2 sophomore from Modesto, California. Second down, draw play. He goes to Filia. He breaks into the secondary, his best run of the afternoon. Close to the first down at the Portland State 39-yard line. Jeff Bockert, number 44, along with Neil Fendel, make the tackle for Portland State.
Getting back to Graziani, Bellotti told us he felt that for the first time in a long, long time, Oregon had a real quality backup quarterback. And it was just a matter of getting some reps, getting in a game. I'm sure that he could not be more pleased right now at this stage than be able to make that substitution.
Graziani threw only four passes last year, 2 of 4. One of them, we remember, a big third down conversion at Colorado State. Here's Dwayne Jones. He's hit at the line of scrimmage by Bocker. Slips off of that hit and gets the first down. Dwayne Jones, one of the good surprises for the Oregon coaching staff in the fall. Had to wait for his opportunity behind Juan Shedrick last year. Now he has that opportunity, and he's ready for a good season. At 245, gives the Ducks a big, strong guy from that fullback position.
The only knock against Jones has been his tendency to lose control of the football at times. They feel that that's something he's going to have to work on. So far, so good.
Now Jones is the lead back, and he gets a nice block, and Filia is upended at the 33-yard line. Boy, that is a textbook tackle by Jeff Bocker. He's been on 5 or 6 tackles already. Good-looking young man from Prairie High School in Washington. And that will be the final play of the first quarter as we take another look at that one. The Oregon Ducks beginning to take control of this game. After the first 15 minutes, it's Oregon 21. Todd McKim along with Ken Woody, the first play of the second quarter. Tony Graziani to throw, and he's hitting belted sack. And Stromberg gets the first sack. Pushes the Ducks back to the 41. Stromberg with 2 sacks last year, 5 tackles for losses. And it looks like the shoulder that he apparently injured earlier is A-OK. Graziani not used to getting sacked. Didn't get sacked all during the spring except for the spring game. He's usually very good on pocket presence, but that time didn't have a chance. Third down. The Ducks perfect on third down so far. And Graziani throws it right-handed, and it's almost intercepted. It hit the back of big Steve Harden, the right tackle. And Graziani showing a little ambidextrous move there.
I'm ambivalent about it. I was watching the left side of the Oregon offensive line the last two plays, and there was a little bit of mix-up, and things didn't look too smooth. However, you're going to see that the pressure's coming from inside. There's a situation where a sophomore is trying to make something happen. I think
down.
And there again, the ball hit an ineligible receiver, so it brings a fumble. So I'm sure Mike Bellotti would say, hey, look, there's nothing there. Throw it up and above those guys out of bounds so no one can pick it off.
His problem was, as a left-handed quarterback, he felt that pressure from his left hand. But you're right, that's a dangerous play. But it's a learning experience, and this is exactly what they wanted to do with Graziani. Get him in a game situation where
He could learn under fire.
It's a lot easier to learn when it's 21-3 and you're ahead than if you're behind 21-3.
I would imagine, though, we would see O'Neal on the next series. Wouldn't surprise me at all, because you don't want to lose, you know, your continuity and focus in the second quarter.
Might depend on field position, too, Todd. Yeah.
So now Matt Belden will punt it away for the first time in his Oregon career. Belden averaged 47.8 yards a punt last year in high school. He's a two-stepper. This one's a wobbler off the side of his foot, so he's learning the hard way, too. Bounces it inside the 25, the 20 consecutive possessions in the first quarter. This is Graziani's second offensive possession. Tailback remains Filiar. He tries to bounce it outside, and no way. Jason Heffley, this guy is a fired-up football player. Aggressive, tough, emotional. They really like him as a leader.
Well, and the Ducks had something inside. Pulu Malapiai, I think that the Gary Campbell, the running back coach, would have hoped Filiar had stayed inside his block. He ended up bouncing it outside, and there was nothing there.
Blake Spence in as a tight end right now. Dameron Ricketts at wide receiver. Seeing a little bit of shuffling up front for Oregon as well. Tasi Malapiai in at right guard. Vikings showing blitz. Now Wilcox. He wants to go in motion awful bad, doesn't he? But they stay there. He gets a good block. Filiar bounces through a crease over the 40 to the 42-yard line. Gain of 8. Let's take you down into the trenches. Brian Stromberg, number 92 in there against Steve Harden.
And one of the things that Portland State felt is they've got some good nose people inside. The Duck offensive line coach, Steve Greatwood, told us, if we can handle their nose, we feel good about the running game. That play, results speak for themselves.
That 8-3 mark, based on his 1 year of tenure, is the best winning percentage for a coach in Portland State history. Graziani. Facing some heat. Over the middle, caught by Wilcox. That should have been an interference call. He was hit before he caught the ball and then dropped it. But pretty good coverage over there. Brockert, Matt Bockert made the stop, made the hit. There's a bang-bang call, and the Ducks will have to punt it away. And the Viking fans get an opportunity to cheer their defense.
Josh, the son of Dave Wilcox, one of the outstanding outside linebackers to ever play the football NFL.
Here comes the rush. Belden, low, end over ender. Fielded. This is Hunden to the outside. And we have a penalty flag. He's down at the 32-yard line. Let's see if Barry was down when the ball came loose. He got a good bounce if he wants to receive it, but that's dangerous. You're running the wrong way. Looks like the ball was down, and the Ducks maintained possession. First play from scrimmage. O'Neal back in at quarterback with a first-team offense, and we have a penalty.
Holding offense. After this, repeat first down.
So imagine the Vikings would take this penalty here and move the Ducks back inside the 10.
And this is just what you don't want as the Oregon offensive coach. I mean, you had your early explosion. Things have been kind of going back and forth. You get your first unit guy in there now, and the first play you get a holding penalty, and you're down around your 10-yard line.
And now Graziani is back in. Well, now they're really putting Graziani in a position where he has to be careful, but yet make plays as well.
Well, and he has most of the first unit offense in there with him. You know, sometimes that works to a quarterback's disadvantage. You put a second-team quarterback in there with the second-team line, and there's, you know, twice as many things to worry about.
Quick pattern. Corey Murphy breaks away from the initial containment. He's out close to the 20-yard line.
Well, and that pass completion there did a lot for Tony Graziani, did a lot for Mike Bellotti. It's going to do a lot for Danny O'Neal. He's sitting there saying, hey, here's a guy. They've got confidence throwing in off the goal line. Now he's doing a pretty good job. It's going to maintain some the competitive juices with O'Neal. I think for the first time in a long time, he's going to have to play sharp to stay in there all season long.
Give it to Filiar. He is not going to get the first down. In fact, may have lost a half a yard on the play. Vikings are pretty good up front with Stromberg, Royster, Akaba Delaney. They really like at the nose. He's a preseason All-American candidate. They're playing today without Tony Bates, a senior from Iowa, transferred from Iowa, had a tragedy in his family a week or so ago and had to fly back to Florida to tend to family matters and hasn't been able to really get in full swing. Graziani on third down to Corey Murphy, and he gets inside John Gentry and picks up the first down, a gain of 5 yards. See the Ducks, 75% on third down attempts. They'll give it to Filiot, trying to bounce to the outside, does momentarily, but closing quickly from the safety position is Eric Reese from Philomath High School.
Last year, the Oregon pass offense averaged over 14 yards of completion, and that's a big, big statistic. Says a couple things. One, they got guys who can do something with it after the catch. Second of all, they're very successful in throwing the ball downfield, putting pressure on secondaries. See Filiot there. You'd like to have seen him put the ball in his outside hand away from those rushers.
Graziani to throw. Pretty good protection. The out pattern is underthrown, intended for Murphy, Reese, and Gentry covering for Portland State. Marcel Stewart checks in replace of Dino Filiot, tailback. So the Ducks will go with the normal set, although they'll split the two wide receivers to the top of the screen. Slant pattern, underthrown, and I'm not sure if that was thrown for Murphy or McLemore, and Graziani continues to struggle. Has not been sharp this fall after a very good spring, and so Oregon is forced to punt it away. So now this game has kind of turned into a lull where neither offense has been able to generate much.
Well, on the positive side there, the Ducks came back from a holding penalty and got a first down. That was a nice little accomplishment. But right now the game is kind of stabilized, and
here's Belden. Comes the heap, it is a two-stepper, he gets it off. A wobbler, Hundon calls for, makes the fair catch of the 44. So Belden has not been able to get one to turn over. He's got a strong leg, but it'll take some time. Only a 28-yard punt, and when we come back, the Vikings will have the football. Vikings football, 5.5 to play in the second quarter. Allen throws the out pattern, caught by Hundon in front of Herman O'Berry, a gain of almost 8.
You asked me what I thought of Allen on that play there. He stepped back and really threw the ball with some authority to the wide side of the field.
Number one mark.
It's almost
junior colleges.
It's almost as good as your mark back in Pennsylvania in high school, Todd.
That was punting. Short yardage situation, but the Vikings may have taken a little bit too much time.
You see some experience there. Kyle Croston called timeout.
Welcome back to Autzen Stadium. Second quarter, Oregon leading Portland State 21-3. The Vikings got on the board first this afternoon. Their initial drive was halted in Oregon territory. Jeff Crowell came in, booted a 45-yard field goal that hit the crossbar and bounced over, and the Vikings had the first points of the game. But on Oregon's first possession, they marched right down the field. Danny O'Neill and company looking very sharp. The touchdown pass to Kristen McLemore from 33 yards out. The next possession, a one-yard run by Kenny Wheaton, and it was 14-3. And then Wilcox, the reception from O'Neill, and the Ducks lead 21-3. Whistle, and we have a flag thrown in.
Dead ball, false start on the offense.
Second and 7. Allen, dump pass over the middle, caught by Steve Pappen. And he slips and falls as Alex Molden was about to hit him.
0 for 5 and third down conversion so far.
Third and 2 here. Allen to throw, and this ball is, oh, what a chunk! This catch by the tight end, Bob Gitsum. Bob Gitsum, a great, great one-handed catch, and a Viking first down. Wow. And he needed all of that 6'6 frame.
That was a tremendous play. That's why Bob is touted as a preseason All-American. Reverting back to a conversation we had Nick Aliotti, the defensive coach, he said, I want to see Chad Cota cover their tight end. He may not make the play, but he's going to be right there. And as you see, Cota trying to catch up to Gitsum. That is a tremendous catch. You won't see much better than that.
No, you will not. The gain of 24, and the Vikings back in Oregon territory for the second time this afternoon.
First third down conversion, 1 for 6 so far.
Allen on a half roll. He's got Croston, first down inside the 10. Dante Lewis made the stop, but Kyle Croston, a young man who attended Oregon, was a quarterback, then a safety. He really looked forward to coming back and playing today here at Autzen Stadium.
Well, there are a lot of people here with mixed emotions right now. I imagine, knowing Kyle as I do, I feel glad that he's out there playing football. On the other hand, catching a first down, getting into scoring territory against Oregon, Not quite so happy about that.
Good kid. Just a real solid good kid. And hope he gets an opportunity to play a lot for the Vikings here in his senior year. It's first and goal from just inside the 10-yard line. Long count. They fake the counter. Here comes Allen on a pitch. No, he keeps it, and he's got some daylight wrapped up from behind. Boy, excellent ball fake there by Kyle Allen. He's down to the Oregon 3, where he's wrapped up by Troy Bailey. Well, this is what Kyle Allen can do and gives Portland State. A guy that can run the football. Great fake that he put on Mark Schmidt.
And your blood pressure goes up as a coach as the ball comes up and over the helmet. You saw O'Neal try to do that. Similar, got a fumble earlier on, but great athletic ability there.
Double tight end for the Vikings. They'll give it to Derek Holmes. He tries the right side. Forget it. Good night. Chad Cota put the helmet on his chest and just buried him. That's how you play strong safety.
Good night. That's a good way to describe that. Watch this hit, folks, on the left side Oregon's defense. Pow!
Got some help from Rich Rule. Look for Hundon or Matt James here. Hundon with that size, and James a real good hands man. They had a little crossing pattern. There's James, touchdown. The Ducks didn't cover the crossing pattern. A little pick down at the goal line. And Matt James with a Portland State touchdown. You can't give a three-yard cushion down at the goal line.
It's the very same play that SC victimized Oregon a couple years ago down here with a little crossing pattern. And credit the great catch by their tight end.
This one's going to be blocking. You can return this. And a good, smart play by the Portland State man right there. So the Vikings get a touchdown. 2:13 to play in the first half. It's Oregon 21, Portland State 9. In all reality, that drive was made by the tremendous catch by Bob Gitschum. He made that super one-handed grab to keep the drive alive. Very impressive. Good mix. Allen was razor sharp, and Matt James gets the touchdown reception. James, a very good receiver. Missed the last four games a year ago with a stress fracture. Graziani's had, I think, three series and unable to move the team. Herman O'Berry about 2 yards deep. And the ball out at the 22. So that's where the Ducks will set up shop, and a good chance here for Oregon to get the opportunity to run that two-minute drill with O'Neal at quarterback. 2:07 remaining in the half.
Go back and look at the Portland State touchdown.
You're going to see the blitz.
Left side, there's just a coverage mess up here, and Molden's trying to get to James. There was a crossing pattern. He just either miscommunicated or got caught up in a pick.
Here's O'Neal. The blitz is on. Dump pass for Filia, incomplete. But into that wind, they'll make it a little more difficult.
That's right. Good point. And if the Ducks don't get a first down or two here, they'll be punting into the wind. Their punting average 30 yards or less.
Here comes the screen. This is well set up, and then they didn't have the right communication. Believe me, folks, that might have been a touchdown. That's how far they had sucked into Portland State defense, and Filiok just couldn't get away from the offensive line.
Well, inadvertently, number 76, Willie Reif, trying to get out of the way, tripped up Filiok. Of course, in a situation like this, he wants to avoid the ball hitting him. That could be a penalty. You see Reif slipping his block on the right side. He's going to come back here, and that... Oh, his left foot makes the tackle. There's a lot of running room out to the left side here.
And with Filiaw's speed, there aren't many guys that would have caught him. But now Portland State wisely takes a timeout. Total yards in the second quarter dominated by Portland State after the Ducks had had about 150 total yards in the first quarter. You sense, you know, you look back and say, what if and that, but the first responsibility is to win the football game. The second one is to play your troops. And the Ducks, in trying to do both simultaneously, maybe have given Portland State a window of opportunity.
They may have. You know, looking ahead here, if the Ducks fail to convert on third down, they have done so 6 out of 9 so far. But they'll be punting into the wind. The last punt rush, Portland State put a lot of pressure on the punter, came very close.
It's third down and about 12. O'Neal, the out pattern for McLemore, and this ball is incomplete. Not a good offensive series by Oregon. Not good timing there. And O'Neal now with his first couple of incompletions of the game.
Well, this is the first third down that O'Neal has failed to convert.
They don't have face guarding in college football or That would have been a classic textbook example of it. Reese made no attempt at the ball. So the freshman, Matt Belden, tested right here, deep in his own territory. They're going to set up the return. It's another wobbling kick that gets a good bounce, and Hundon has to watch it roll. The bounce adds another 17 yards to the 10 yards, and the Ducks will have the football inside the 20-yard line.
That's a big turnabout. You know, Portland State 21-9 going in is in their control. But you could see that coming, Todd. There were really only three guys in coverage. Everyone else was out of position or blocked. And had a punt been kicked long enough earlier, O'Berry might have been able to do that earlier in the kick contest.
You saw his great speed, though, going from one sideline to the other to pick up the wedge. So it's first and goal for Oregon. The ball marked at the 9-yard line. O'Neill already has two touchdown passes this afternoon, one to McLemore and one to Josh Wilcox.
And if I were the Ducks right now, I would run the same pattern Portland State ran against me earlier. There's a little bit of a mismatch out here. The safety, number 22 on McLemore.
Right side, nothing doing. So it'll be second down and goal from the 9. At halftime, we'll get you all up to date with the statistics, have the first half highlights, talk about the second half. Dino Filioff, 14 carries today, 41 yards. Ricky Whittle, the fractured thumb in the final preseason scrimmage. He has a cast on the thumb, and as soon as the adhesions heal, he may be able to come back. O'Neill stumbles, fires near side. This one is batted away at the last minute by Larry Austin.
Team All-American last year, and he was actually... The Ducks are lucky he didn't pick it and go the distance here. But this is a risky play. As you can see, O'Neill stumbles, coming out from the center, throws the ball to the wide side of the field. It's in the air a long time. Austin makes the gamble and cuts the ball off. Still, the mismatch is on the safety against the inside receiver. You're going against their best man-man defender there.
Here's the screen set up to Filioff. Does he have the speed at the corner? Yes, he does. And he got a tremendous block by Willie Wright. Johnson over his head and threw for the touchback. Let's look at the scoring drives. First of all, the possessions for Oregon. You can see they came out of the gate very quick. That third score, the result of a fumble recovery at the Portland State 19-yard line. And then they finished the half strong thanks to the punt return and the touchdown pass to Filioff. For Portland State, they started very good as well. Field goal on the opening possession, and then sputtered a bit before finally putting together that 56-yard touchdown drive. So the Oregon first team offense in there to start the second half. They'll give it to Filioff, try the sweep. He bounces to the outside, not a good decision. Holding call on Wilcox, and Filioff is buried for a loss of 5.
Well, we alluded at halftime about the coordination between the backs and the offensive line. There's a situation. Filioff had something had he been able to cut that ball up inside. As you can see, you'd like Filioff to cut inside Wilcox's block there. There's no way you're going to beat him outside. Second down.
And then plenty of help from his mates.
And it looked like Eric Reed had been pulling too, and there was something. But that's something that's going to have to be worked. There have been times they've not run that many in a game.
This is Blake Spence in motion, redshirt freshman tight end. They'll give it to Filioff. Now he cuts it up there with good hard running this time. Gains 7. Will come out in this passing, probable passing situation. Spence again goes in motion. O'Neill looking for the screen back. Great play by Eric Reese, the safety. Oh, he slipped inside there, and we have a late flag thrown as well. Personal foul against Portland State will wipe away that fine defensive play.
As you can see, Filioff drifts to his right, then comes back to the left, and here's a situation where the force man is too far upfield before Reed, the kickout guy, could get there. That's just a great, great reaction by the safety.
The personal foul after the play on Portland State. O'Neill in the pocket. McLemore incomplete. Good pressure this time as, once again, it's Brian Stromberg applying the heat. I do want to mention O'Neill. For all that has been said about him statistically, the one statistic that might be as important as anybody else or anything else is that he has started the last 24 games.
He's been very durable after a period of which you never knew who was going to play quarterback for the Ducks. One thing is, we're not going to be able to see it, but O'Neal did a nice job of stepping up there. Years past, we've seen him get a little bit confused and start running around. That's an area of the game that he has really improved on.
Seeing total yards right up there. O'Neal, again, eludes pressure. He needs to get down, and he's belted down.
Good outside pressure there. And O'Neal showing what athlete he is.
Wow, Ken Harrison, young man from Walla Walla Community College, got a big hit. Quick out pattern to Murphy. Did he catch it? Did he get his hands underneath? They say yes, and he has the first down. The Portland State coaching staff trying to lobby for the incompletion.
I think it's an optometrist nightmare. Obviously, only half the design got to the factory.
There's some power running inside by Dino Filias. The Ducks try to soften up the belly there. Eric Reese along with Marcus Royster for Portland State. Marcus Royster's twin brother, Mazio Royster, played for USC. Filias now the cutback, trying to get the Jets going. And he puts his head down a little bit short of the first down and a late flag, two flags down on the play. The opening possession of the third quarter. Face mask infraction against Portland State, and that will give Oregon a first down. Oregon leading 28-9. O'Neal pass. Reads the defense out to Philly on the flat. 35-30. Breaks a tackle. 25 down to the 22-yard line. Good effort by Dino Filia. Just a little swing pattern, and Filia doing it on his own.
Nice job by O'Neal there of waiting for Filia to clear the defender. That's a play earlier they had attempted, and Filia had dropped the ball.
And Filia still learning. You have to remember that he did not play a whole lot at Taft Junior College and didn't play that much last year. And you can see Rick Anderson finally had to make the tackle.
John Gentry, number 23, was faked out completely on that play.
O'Neal over the middle, and he overthrows Josh Wilcox. Second down and 10 for Oregon. Go back to the eye. This is Kenny Wheaton to the outside. And oh, great play over there by Burroughs. And now you can see why they like him. Not only took on the blocker, but made the stop.
One thing about young running backs who have great speed, they have a tendency to rely on that speed and oftentimes take the ball outside when they should try to head it up inside. Again, another situation, they may not go for a touchdown turning it inside, but they're getting caught running sideways.
So Wheaton stays in. Dwayne Jones, the fullback. Split near side, Murphy and McLemore. Here's O'Neal. Nobody open, now he'll scramble. And he'll just take it out of bounds and get as much as he can. Good play by O'Neal. He'll gain about 5 yards, and that'll set up a field goal attempt. Ryan Perry Smith will be the holder.
Back to attempt the field goal.
Snapper is Rob Williams. Pretty good snap and hold. Penalty flag. The kick is up and the kick is through, but let's await the penalty flag. And now they're going to wave it off. So that's a field goal for Matt Belden, his first. He's happy about that, and why not? The Ducks extend their lead 31-9 on the field goal by Matt Belden. So Belden now to kick it away. This will be Larry Austin at the 8. Tries the outside. It's foot race now. 30 out near the 35-yard line.
Aggressiveness. Get that unit fired up.
O'Neal remains the quarterback. Pulo Malapai is the lone back. He comes out of the backfield. O'Neal far side. Wilcox has it. Gain of about 6. Ridden out of bounds over there, once again, by Sammy Burroughs.
Well, and here's the situation now. It's a short yardage situation where the Ducks look for play action possibly here. O'Neal right on the money. Good catch by Wilcox. I think the Ducks are in pretty good shape at tight end this year.
Yeah, they have several good quality young tight ends. Wilcox, Matt Reinhardt injured, a redshirt freshman. Blake Spence, good hands. Out of the backfield, penalty flag, two of them. Marcel Stewart took his eyes off the football, getting his first Division I experience. Young 6-foot junior from Diablo Valley Junior last year. He ran for 900 yards in a one-back offense.
Offense.
For the featured
offside
back there. And
defense.
Had a couple of big games,
repeat
172 yards versus West Valley, and then 189 yards and two touchdowns against the College of Sequoias. But,
well, they've waved off the penalty flag. That was nice of them.
Yes. Ron Richmond are... Oh, offsetting penalties, excuse me. So now they give it on the draw to Stewart. Nice hole there, and he has the first down to the 24-yard line. Let's take a look at Steve Harden, a big 324-pound All-American candidate.
Considered one of the premier offensive tackles in college football there. His job was to seal the inside gap, and he did do just that. It's a lot easier to do at 300 pounds.
Here's the counterplay. Get up the field, Stewart. He does. Puts his head forward, and now the Oregon offensive line beginning to take control of the line of scrimmage.
Talking with Gary Campbell yesterday about Stewart. Stewart pulled his hamstring the first day of practice in a warm-up drill designed to stretch out the hamstring.
I just stretched it too far. Marcus Royster and Jason Nye, the stop for Portland State. Now he'll come out of the ball game.
I predict a fine career for Marcel as long as he can get past warm-ups.
Kenny Wheaton back in at tailback. O'Neill to throw. Wheaton through his hands.
Well, I think.
And Willie Reif and Jeff Bockert have words, and Bockert with a shove to Reif, who walks away.
Well, Wheaton's arm shrunk a little bit as the ball led him inside towards those two inside linebackers.
Yeah, he got the alligator arms.
Yeah, and you know, it's a long season. It's 12 games. You got to live.
He may want to go back to defense where they do the hitting.
Ducks 1-for-3 third down conversions so far this half.
There's Wheaton trying to find a seam. He's got the first down on third and one. And who do you go behind? You go behind 324 Steve Harden and about 305 Willie Reif. So you're about 630 pounds.
Well,
much of humanity.
Much has been said about the inexperience of that offensive line, but I think there's a lot of talent there.
Here's a little screen under with Dameron Ricketts. He gets inside the five and is upended there by, once again, Sammy Burroughs. That's a play that Oregon has run for a number of years now with a lot of success. I remember Terry Obey running that play and having great success.
It's an interesting play. All the linemen are running to the outside while the receiver comes across. It looks a little bit like your typical traffic intersection in Albuquerque.
The green light is at all four stops.
Yeah. It's a flashing green light.
Should I go or not? With an ambulance parked nearby, right?
Yeah, you shut your eyes and just run.
Here's Filiot looking to power it in. He's at the goal line and into the end zone for the touchdown, his second of the day. And that may be the end of the activity for guys like O'Neill and Filiot this afternoon.
Well, Oregon really mixed it up on the run and the pass there. Getting a chance to bring those young running backs along, and the offensive line, they need those repetitions too.
And he does. So a good day kicking for Matt Belden. Well, the Ducks have now scored here in the third quarter on two possessions, a field goal and also a touchdown, and have extended this lead to 29 points. Kickoff fielded by Austin at the 7, and there goes Austin again, and Isaac Walker had to make the stop.
And the Ducks have made a couple of substitutions on their kickoff coverage, but on the left side they've been losing contain. This time the return man comes up inside, and again the left side of the kickoff coverage a little bit shaky. Belden the kicker. You know, how many times did we see Tommy Thompson in that situation?
That's right. Anybody we've seen. Remember, he had the three interceptions against Cal when he was guarding Sean Dawkins a couple of years ago. Here's Dameron Ricketts. Almost came down with it.
Oh,
he did come down with it, they say.
Great effort by Ricketts, though. He was covered like a blanket.
Couple of number threes going battle on the sideline.
O'Neill puts it up there in a position where only the receiver is going to get a shot at it. And does he have it?
Yeah, he does. He had the left foot in bounds.
Yeah,
I mean, it's bang, bang, and you'd like to get those every week.
26-yard pass and reception. You got to get them at home.
Two spectacular plays in a row. Here's the reverse to Ricketts. He's got one man to beat. Good play by Ted Leach to hang in there
And we have a late flag again. This will be against Portland State.
Premier statistician Ron Richmond at halftime was mentioning that he would like to see the end around, and what a great time to call it. Pretty good blocking there. Ron, nice call. Ricketts does a nice job of turning it inside. A late hit by...
That was Royster, I believe. Marcus Royster got into it with somebody over there. And we have a Portland State player injured. Well, you know, there have been some lulls in this game, but these last three plays, Ken, you've got the interception by O'Berry, the great catch by Ricketts, and now the reverse by Ricketts.
Well, we saw it in the spring game. You know, Oregon's got a lot of offensive weapons. I was a little mystified by the ninth place picking by the coaches. I kind of felt like there might be a little sandbagging going on. Oregon still has some questions to answer, but they really got some nice skill people on the outside, and Rich Brooks is getting a chance right now to look at some of those young guys and see what they're capable of doing.
Running clock, third quarter, 5:12 back for Oregon as they take over at the 42-yard line. Go back to Kenny Wheaton. He cuts back into the middle. A good line surge gets him about three. And now one senses, just looking at some of the extracurricular activity going on after plays, an immense amount of frustration. There's a lot of yakking and talking now that we didn't see in the first quarter. Jeff Buckert right there getting into it a bit with Dwayne Jones.
Yeah, and, you know, things are going against them. We identified on the last series the Portland State defense is losing a little bit of its cohesiveness and discipline. And you'll watch this. This is the kind of stuff that happens after the game. Bockworth looks like he's trying to break off the face mask.
Graziani scurries out of bounds right at about the line of scrimmage.
That's a great job on the replay there.
Yeah.
A lot of times.
Good camera work.
Well, it was such a good replay, we wanted to miss that 3-yard gain. But I don't think Bockworth was saying, hey, nice run on that play.
So Graziani in there at quarterback, Wheaton along with Dwayne Jones, wide receivers Ricketts and Patrick Johnson. Here comes the blitz by Portland State, and that one is intercepted. And this one may be a touchdown. It will be a touchdown unless he falls over his own man. And running from the score is Ken Harrison. I don't know where Graziani was throwing that one.
Fortunate because his tight end was wide open over the middle for a first down.
64-yard interception for the touchdown. Embarrassment of all embarrassments, tackled by a cheerleader.
Well, it's an embarrassment of two different kinds there, as you see Graziani getting the word from Coach Brooks and Mike Bellotti.
Extra point by Crowell is good, and so the Vikings on the board thanks to their defense. 16, 2:24 remaining in the third period. The Vikings get their second six-pointer of the afternoon.
Graziani had just decided who he was going to throw to before, and he threw it to a covered outside receiver, and you can see that once he released it, he never saw the rest of it, which is probably good because it was touchdown the other way.
Crowell, another booming kick. This will go through the end zone.
It's been more of a case of Portland State unable to cover the big play players of the Ducks.
Marcel Stewart with the handoff from Graziani. So now we're going to see the reserves for Oregon in this situation. Rick Anderson, the stop for Portland State. A chance for some of these guys that haven't played at all in a Division I game.
Their players maintain focus on the game. There's a lot of pushing and discussion after every, this is what's, you know, these two schools are 2 hours apart, and a lot of people know each other and have probably given each other a hard time about this game for a long time.
Well, let's go back to why this game was scheduled as we see the penalty flag there. This game was scheduled initially because Oregon got a 12th game opportunity by going to Hawaii, so they could play a 12th game. Meanwhile, Portland State is having tremendous success at the Division II level, and Pokey Allen, then the coach at Portland State, you know, it really had the folks in the Portland area excited about his program, and there was talk at the time, whether it was boosters or whatever, people in the media, hey, you know, Portland State's pretty good. You know, maybe they can go down there and beat Oregon. Remember, Oregon in 1991 had that horrible year. And so they scheduled the game. Portland State gets a guarantee of 75,000.
Blake Spence on the reception. He turns it upfield, and he can run. This guy is a big, strong, fast tight end, and he's got a first down before knocked out of bounds. Gain of 28 yards.
16 for 24, Danny O'Neill.
See, Danny O'Neill has the number of 300-yard or four touchdown pass games as all the other Oregon quarterbacks combined. Pretty impressive company. First down, it comes to Marcel Stewart. Left side, 45-40, 38-yard line.
Well, getting back to that, how the game came about, you know, Pokey, in building his program, did a lot of face-to-face work with the corporate world. And, you know, frankly, Portland State at that stage really depended on that. They don't get a Rose Bowl share like the Ducks do and a lot of the other television revenues and so on. So it's been interesting to hear of the kind of bitter rivalry over the corporate dollar.
Mm-hmm. Graziani to throw. Has time. Throws deep. He's got a man, Patrick Johnson, and he can't quite get to it. Pass interference on Portland State. Fendel got turned around a little bit as Patrick Johnson tried to come back for the ball.
I'll tell you, nothing can make up for speed. Nice job by Graziani of stepping up. He knows he's going to get hit. Puts the ball out there. And that interference, that bumping there, definitely.
Patrick Johnson from Redlands, California. Here's the handoff once again to Marcel Stewart. And it's Fendel making the stop at the 20-yard line. Gain of four. Patrick Johnson, the speedster out of Redlands. The coaches describe him, and you know, a lot of guys that run 10-3 are track guys that they convert into football players. But Mike Bellotti believes that Patrick Johnson is a football player who just happens to run 10-3. And Damon Griffin, the other freshman wide receiver that we may see at some point in the season from Monrovia, California, also a league sprint champion. So the Ducks trying to recruit speed at the wide receiver position.
Well, I think their attitude, the coaches, is that although we do have these older receivers who have proven track records, we've got some young guys in a position to play and do some things right away. So we're not gonna keep them in storage all along. And it's nice they get a situation here where they can get in some good game action. Pick up a 2-for-1 certificate.